All right. We'll get started here in a couple minutes. See, we've got a few people online at this point. Can everybody hear me okay? Linda, can you hear me?
I can hear you.
All right. Before we get started, is there any, just curious if I have time at the end, is there any questions anyone wants me to be sure to answer? Since you guys are here early, you can ask your questions before we officially get started, huh? Well, if no one has any questions, that's fine. We can get started in a couple minutes. Looks like we should have a pretty big group here today. Got about 25 people signed up. You cannot hear me now, Bob? Your question? I wasn't
talking. I can hear you.
Okay. I was just being quiet. Okay. It's 1 o'clock, so I'm going to give us maybe another 1 or 2 minutes, and then we'll get started. My goal is to try to finish this a little bit early so that we can have some questions, but please don't hesitate to use the little Q&A area, and I can read those as we go, and I can hopefully answer questions as we go along as well. If I miss your Q&A and I'm just talking too much, I apologize. All right. Well, it's a couple minutes after one, at least from my office, and I think I'm going to get started. We have a lot to cover, and just want to thank everybody for coming to this webinar today. And the goal is to provide an overview of CiviCRM, and hopefully give you some idea of its capabilities and functionalities, and maybe some tips on how to use it. But basically, let me give you a little intro first. I'm not sure exactly where everyone's coming from. But CiviCRM is, some people call it just a CRM or an AMS or a donor management system. But basically, it's used by nonprofits and associations and sort of member-driven organizations around the world. It's been around for more than 10 years now. It is open source, basically meaning that it's free to use as much as you want. It's got very strong functionality. It competes extremely well against sort of non-open source CRMs and AMSs. When I say AMS, I should explain that. That's an association management system. And it's got generally very strong functionality. The innovation that's happening on Civi is extremely good. And the cost is, of course, since it's free, is always very attractive. Of course, there are some costs involved in CiviCRM, generally hosting, and that can range from, you know, maybe $20 a month to significantly more than that, depending on what your needs are. There are a lot of modules within Civi, things like contacts, contributions, events. You'll see them across the top part of my screen here, the main ones, contacts, contributions, events, mailing, membership. There's actually other ones, but those are the ones that we're going to sort of go through today. One of the big strengths of CiviCRM is its ability to integrate with websites. Most of the CiviCRMs that have been implemented have been integrated with Drupal, which is an extremely powerful content management system. But there's also a vast growing number of integrations with WordPress, and there's also some integrations with Joomla. It also has a very strong API, which means that it can integrate in with a lot of other things besides just sort of the website. So you've got other things, like if you have like a learning management system or something like that, it usually can be integrated in pretty easily. Other thing is, it's got a lot of extensions. So if you guys are familiar with WordPress or Drupal or things like that, there's modules or items that are not native to that particular piece of technology, but that other people have created and then have integrated into that technology. So for example, in CiviCRM, two very popular extensions of it are the volunteer extension, which allows you to manage volunteers at events, and also a MailChimp integration, which allows you to take advantage of the great MailChimp functionality without without having to have two separate processes between your mass mailing. So those are just two examples, but there must be 100 extensions out there now. Some of them are really functional and some of them are barely functional. I think that's true across the whole open source environment. Before we get started too, there's if I could ask everyone to mute themselves, unless you're asking a question, I can hear some typing. And I'm guessing that not everyone wants to hear that. So you could do that, that'd be helpful. Just to give you a little background on who, I'm Paul Kogan, and I'm founder of Back Office Thinking, and we do a lot of CiviCRM implementations. We've got about 80, 85 clients we're gonna work with this year, and about half of them use CiviCRM. So we've got some pretty good experience. We tend to work with larger organizations, but we have several smaller clients as well. What we're gonna do is, I'm going to try to give a demo today of the of the overall functionality. Right now, I am showing you just a static image of the CiviCRM homepage, and I will go. I'll start migrating around the site in a minute. Once we get through the basic modules, I'm going to talk a little bit about sort of the different data points. And one of the areas that I find organizations have a lot of problems with is understanding tags, groups, custom data, relationships, smart groups, when you use them, how do you use them. And that's really important because that will help you define how best to use CiviCRM. Okay, so let's get started. CiviCRM, when you log in, you come to their homepage, which is a dashboard. This dashboard has been configured already to put a bunch of different dashlets on here. If you have capability, you can configure your dashboard by pressing here and moving these different dashlets in and out. And these are typical ones where you've got some event summary income. Maybe it lists your top donors. Maybe it lists your membership summary or some activities that you need to do or someone in your organization needs to do. You've got a lot of flexibility on your dashboard. Most reports that are in the system can be configured so that they can be put on your dashboard. And this dashboard is for you, so other people can have different dashboards when they log in. So for contacts, CiviCRM is a contact-based system, meaning that everything has contacts. There are, in the base system, there are individuals, households, and organizations. And you can have sub-contacts or subtypes of these contacts. So for example, here, you'll see that an organization can be either a team or a sponsor. The good thing is that you can have someone that is in multiple organizations, or if you have individuals, they can be in multiple subtypes. And we'll talk later about why those might be important. If we take a look at a contact record, sort of the easiest way is to do this quick search up here in the corner. And I'm just going to find a record, hopefully, pretty easily. So let's go with Tom Brady, which is a really bad choice for me because I'm a Jets fan and I can't stand anyone from New England. The New England Patriots, I should say. So this is an example of a contact record. This is an individual contact record. You can see because it's got a little picture of an individual here. Now, on this contact record, there is summary data, which has the basic data that you'd expect to see, things like their employer information, basic email, website address, as well as some CiviCRM specific data. And maybe some other things around their preferences, around their communication, and their basic demographic information. Other information can be added to this summary tab through what's called custom data. And here's an example of a piece of custom data that's been added to this summary tab. It's called constituency information, and this is called a data set. And within here, you can have all these different data fields. So what's really great about Civi is it's so easy to add the data that's important to you. I'm not going to go through today the process, unless we have time at the end, of actually creating these data sets and data fields. But I'll explain a little bit more about them as we go. Also on the contact record, if they've given any contributions, you'll see them right here. And you can also submit a contribution, either a back-end one by check or cash or you can submit a live credit card contribution if your system has been enabled with that. It has pledging information as well, so you can make pledges. And these, so basically if someone is saying, I'm going to give you $50 in the next 2 months and I'm going to give it to you in two different payments, you can add those pledge information in here. Memberships. So it will give you an idea of all the memberships that are active, and if there were any inactive ones, you'd see them here as well. Any activities that they have, and activities are really robust in CiviCRM. So pretty much anything that anyone does is recorded in an activity. So notice this is a membership sign-up. So Tom Brady signed up as a member, And if you, this person was sent an email, you'd see it. If they gave a contribution, they'd see it. If they went into a an event or any of those activities or items that they've done, you'll see it right here. You can also create activities yourself to be done on a particular contact record. So, for example, if I want someone to call Tom Brady later on, I can create an activity, excuse me, right here, that's added by me with Tom Brady. I'm going to assign it to someone else, this person, and it's going to be call. And basic information is, well, what day and time do you want to do it on? So we're going to do it on the 22nd at 6 p.m. It's scheduled, and I'm going to say ask for a donation. And you can add a lot more pieces of data on here as well. So like I said before, that custom data, you can apply custom data right here. So you can add a lot more detailed information about this activity. You can schedule follow-ups. You can add attachments. You can change the whole priority. But if I save this now, you'll then see back in Tom's record, there is a schedule of a phone call. And if I were to go to the assigned record, I would see it on her record as well. And it can be set up so that emails, they're actually set up so that you can set reminders.
Hello, Paul. I cannot hear you.
Yeah, I can't hear him either on meeting burner.
Okay, Paul. There's a couple of us that can't hear you.
I can't hear you either. You just dropped out like you muted.
I can't hear either.
This is Paul. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yeah, I can.
Okay. I'm not sure exactly what happened there, but it does say on my screen that I've lost audio. So let me continue on. So on this contact record, you can see pretty much anything that this contact does or is interacted with, you can see right on their main contact, including any relationships, groups, notes, any tags you have for them, and there is a change log. Now, this change log is pretty basic, so it doesn't really provide a lot of detail as to what exactly was changed, and it doesn't record all of the changes. So for some people who expect to get every detailed change on here and what it was, it's not going to give you that information. There is a way to do that, but it's not standard within a Civi setup. So besides the contact information itself, you may want to know how to search for contacts, and there's many ways to do that. I showed you initially this sort of simple search, and you can search just by typing in someone's name, or if you choose email or street address, you can find their information directly there. There's also you can find contacts through a simple find contact, through an advanced search, through a full text search, which means if the text applies anywhere or is located anywhere on their contact record, you will find it. And also something called Search Builder. Search Builder is an advanced search technique, which is a little bit like a
a little bit like a query builder, or you know, a little bit SQL-ish, a little more advanced than the other ones. And you can also find other information through the search, like contributions and mailings and memberships and sort of everything here. And you, there's also a number of custom searches that have been built and are shipped with CiviCRM. You can build your own custom searches if you know how to build searches. We often build some for our clients that have some sophisticated search needs that either does not work, or they don't want to have to build it each time to use it different searches. If we take a look at advanced search in Civi, this is where most people go to find a lot of their contacts. What this is like a giant filter, right? So if I put in someone's name in here, like S, M, I think there wasn't any S, M earlier. If I put in S, I'm going to come up with every single contact in the system that has an S in their name. So here there were 166 of them. I can go back and edit the search criteria and say, well, no, I only want people with an S in their name that have, that are in a particular country or city, they have particular custom data on their record, or really any of these fields. They have a certain relationship, they've gotten certain mailings, they've given a contribution, they are a member, they've been to a particular event. So you can really use this well to narrow down the search. But going right now with the search results that I just found, this is a typical search result screen. It can be changed, but this is basically how it works out of the box. So it's going to have the constituent's name, and you can see this is an organization, and this is an individual. And if you hover over that, you'll see that there's a little more information. So if you're, maybe you have two people with the same name, you're not quite sure who they are. Well, you can, if you hover over here, you may get more information. Well, this person's from New York, and this person's from Pennsylvania, so you'd know who the person was. It's from here, you can either go directly to a contact record. You can view their information, and you can start editing their main contact details, as well as some other things that you can do right here, adding contributions, memberships, relationships. The other thing which is really powerful in Civi is that I can choose all or maybe some of these records. I'm going to choose these first three, and I can use this actions button up here. In actions, I can add all three of these to an event, to a group. I can update their information by what's been called a batch profile, which allows you to enter a lot of information on a group of records at the same time. If you have permissions, you can have delete and permanently delete contacts. And this is an important point. What we recommend is that you do not give permanent delete to almost anyone in your firm. Allow people to delete contacts, but if they're deleted and they have permission, if people have permission, then they can go and remove them from trash and bring them back into your normal database. You can also export these contacts with almost every piece of contact information that's on them into an Excel spreadsheet. Create mailing labels. You can also merge contacts, and Civi's got a pretty sophisticated merging dedupe process, which I'm not going to get into here today, but it's rather good. You can create smart groups, and I will get into that a little bit later, but basically what it is, it's a way to keep your query. So if I put all these people in a smart group, then anyone who had a name that had an S somewhere in their name or their email would automatically become part of this smart group. So as people move in and move out, it's used often, let's say, for a geographic search. So maybe they have an address in California. So if someone new goes into your database and they're in the address of California, they'll automatically become part of that group. You don't have to do anything. You can print letters directly from here. You can record activities, restore contacts from that were deleted. You can send mass mailings as well as individual mailings, as well as SMS. So you can send text messages, but you do need to have a contract with an SMS service to do this. It's not, it's free within Civi, but you need to have a contract with an SMS service to do that. So there's just a lot that you can do from this search results screen. Okay. So, like I said, there's other search ways of doing it. If you're just looking for something quickly, you can go and just do a find contacts here, and here you only have name, email, type of contact, group, and tag. So if it's a pretty simple search, you can often use this. And when you do this, you end up with really the same exact search results screen that you were on before. So that's sort of the beauty of, one of the beauties of Civi is that you always end up on the same search results screen, no matter whether you use a simple search like I just did or the most complicated search builder process. It's very easy to navigate back and forth. And it's usually most people find it very easy to search and then work with the results because of all the different actions that are capable. All right, moving right along, and I'm sorry, I'm going fast because there's really a lot to cover. The next area I want to talk about are contributions. And Civi has a very sophisticated donation or contribution process. It compares very favorably to even some of the largest systems out there, and we'll often move organizations from very large systems to CiviCRM simply because there's very little value in what they're paying those monthly software costs. This has been a big improvement of Civi over the last couple of years, but it's got very sophisticated, batch data entry if that's important to you. And for some of the larger organizations, moving from things like Kintera or Razor's Edge or things like that, it's like it's got all that capability. You can do batches, you can export batches, and you can really have a strong accounting process. I'm not going to talk too much more about that, but just know that it is there. We have several clients that are using this, and they find it extremely helpful. Civi, you can take contributions from the back end as well as the front end. On the front end, they're called contribution pages, and you can set up as many of those as you want. And that's basically what a contribution page is. It's a way for someone on your website to click on a link that says donate, let's say, and go to a page where they can enter their information and their credit card, and that will process the donation directly to your bank account through authorize.net or PayPal or one of the credit card processes that Civi supports. You can do both credit card as well as some of the processors use ACH or bank checks, and you can also do one-time and recurring donations. I know recurring donations is a big deal for a lot of organizations, being able to take those online. Anything that you can do online, you can do on the back end as well. So if people are taking something over the phone, or you've gone to an event and you've got a bunch of information, you can actually put the credit cards through the back end. If someone, let's say you're at an event and you've got a little Square reader and you've already got the information in your bank account, you can put that information into Civi on the back end without having to put any of the credit card information in, just mark that it was taken through a credit card. And of course, it's got the ability to take checks and cash as well. To find contributions in Civi or to create a new one, it's new contribution or find contributions. You can also import a bunch of them. So a lot of times if you're moving over to CiviCRM from another system, you need to import contributions from your old system. Something on the bottom here called price sets, I'm not going to get into those too much, but if you have a very sophisticated donation process or event process, you can come up with some pretty cool systems to allow you for people to have a lot of options. Like for example, you can have a price set that says, I'm gonna give you this donation, and I'm also gonna sign up for, I don't know, if I'm going to an event, or I can say, well, I'm going to do, I want to pay $10 for babysitting or $10 for a brochure. Those are optional things that you can purchase. So the straight contribution pages out of the box without a price set up. It's you're just basically entering in how much money are you going to be donating, and you can have some options. I want to give $10 or $50 from a drop down. But if you have price sets, you can create a much more sophisticated look. To find contributions in CiviCRM, you basically go into the find contribution page, and this is sort of like an advanced search we saw for the individuals or for the people. But it just got different information. So for example, like it's got contribution dates, and you can find different contribution amounts and whether they're completed or pending. So I'm just going to take a look and say, you know, in the last quarter, how many contributions have I found? And here are all the ones that have come in the last quarter. A question came up I saw where it said, you know, that your menus may not look exactly like the ones I'm showing you here. That's probably because if you've got different menus, you can in the administration, I'm not going to go through exactly how to do this, there's a way to change the menus. So Civi's going to come out of the box with a pretty reasonable menu structure. This training area may have been changed, or the ones that you're working on may have been changed. Another question came in about, can you search with multiple emails or records? So if someone has multiple emails and you put in their email address, it will come up. There's not a way right now in this simple search to say search on this email and that email. If you want to do that, you need to go into the search builder, and then you can say, you know, either this address or that address. In the advanced search or the simple searches, it's more of a filter, where in the search builder, if this makes sense, you can do a little more like query-based structuring, so you can say this one or this one or this one and this one. Okay? So from this find contribution section, you can see all the different contributions, and you can, from here, you can do things like, oh, I have to check a couple of them. I can delete them, I can export them, I can send thank you letters, I can update their statuses, I can put them into a batch. And so that's pretty powerful. The other thing is that you'll notice these are all donation or member dues or event fees. You can create as many of these different financial types as you want. So you can you can have offline donations. I know there's a question came in about can you do gift certificates and things for like silent auction and prizes. You can put in any type that you want in here. It doesn't have to be money. It can be we have a lot of clients that when they do auctions or people provide gifts in kind, you can add them right here as a type of transaction. You can search by, of course, receive date, what's their status. You can edit and delete or view any of these individual contributions. It's pretty sophisticated in what it can do. You can also add on contributions. So when you're setting up like a contribution page or contribution record type on the back end, like let's say you wanted to have one that was gifts in kind, but you needed a lot more detail because of your organization. You can add as many of these custom data fields I talked about earlier on contributions. So it may be you might want to say this was for an auction event, or you know, you may want to have to describe what this gift in time was, what this gift in kind was. You can also, a lot of organizations add things in here like different types of codes that it may be one financial type, but you've sent out a mailing and people send back that mailing, so you want to mark that this was the particular mailing that you got your donation based on. So in your marketing, you can go in here and say, okay, which ones worked well, which ones did not work well. Okay, so that's contributions. Next I'm going to go over to events, and you'll see a very similar structure. So I can register people directly here. I can find participants. I can get event reports. I can import these participants, and I can manage all of my events right here. There's also a concept of a personal campaign page, which you may or may not need, where basically it works where you create a particular campaign page that works off of a contribution. So like, for example, some organizations have a contribution or an event area that people then respond to, and then they try to get, you know, their contacts or their friends to then donate to them through that contribution page, and that's oftentimes what you'll see here. But I'm not going to go into much more than that. That's more sophisticated use. But for basically, when you go to manage events, you can see all of your different event pages. And if I went to manage contributions over here, I would see something similar. But I'm going to go through the events area. So on here, you can see here are some of upcoming events, and it gives you some basic information. From here, you can go to the register. You can register a participant. I can go to a live registration page. I can show you how one of those looks. So here's a registration page. So it's got information about, you know, first name, last name, email address, which thing am I going to, and then my credit card information. Pretty simple one. From here, I can also view reports for all, you know, who's registered for my event, who's been a no-show, what's the public participant listing, and I can configure it. So I'm going to go into this configuration. This is how you'd set up a normal event as well. When you're setting up an event for the first time, you'll move through basically like a little wizard where you start off on this first one, info, and then move to a location and fees and online registrations and so forth. Once the event is set up, then you'll see all of the tabs right here over the top. So you can have event types. This one is a fundraiser. When someone registers online, what is their role? It's got, you know, titles and descriptions and all sorts of options around when does it start, stop. You can also do maximum participants and put people on wait lists. Again, it's a pretty sophisticated event system. The event location is set up here. You can use an existing one or you can create a new one. One good thing too is it Civi integrates in with the Google location, so you don't have to know the latitude or longitude. If you put in an address, Civi will find it for you and then it will mark it. So anyone in the system that has an address or any event that had an address or an organization, it'll get mapped. And sometimes that's pretty cool because you can actually go into the search and you can search and find contacts within a particular region, and you can see if, let's say, if your development director is going to Chicago next week, you can see, are there any people who've given me a significant amount of donations in that area? Maybe they can visit them while they're out there. So this is the event location, and here we can set up these different fees. So here we've got these three different fees, and you may remember seeing these over here on this page, where here are the different tournament fees. This is a not very sophisticated event. If we had a price set, we could create a much more sophisticated one. But this is a typical event where you've got a couple different fee options, but nothing overly complicated. And this does indicate that this is a paid event. It doesn't need to be a paid event. We can have it be an event that doesn't require any payment at all. You have the option of putting in different payment processors. In this case, we have a test one. You can also enable pay later. So you can give them information saying, you know, you can register, and then if you choose to pay later, your registration has been taken, but it's not in the registered status. It's in the pending status, and it will not be converted to registered until the payment is actually received. This shows what you can do for online registration. So here's the link text and all of the sort of matching rules to make sure you don't have any duplicates, and I'm not going to get into that right now, but in here you can put in registration text, and so on the registration screen, on the confirmation screen, on the thank you screen, you'll have information that you can put in, you can put on there, so it reads nicely and it matches what your registration needs are. This does not have right now what's called a WYSIWYG that will allow you to edit with rich HTML text. So like we saw on a couple other pages, this can be added here as well. I'm trying to show you, make sure that makes sense what I just said. Notice here it's got the complete editor here. This also can be added here. So if you want to put additional information, you can add it. You can add it right here. It also has confirmation emails, and you can do some things like BCC yourself or other people, so that they can be they'll be notified if there is an event. You can also, like I said, this has the volunteer extension, I'm guessing, on it if it comes up, which means that it doesn't look like I can get there. So the volunteer extension is not installed, or at least not installed properly here, but if you could, you could describe what type of volunteers that you wanted and allow them to register directly here. You can also send out scheduled reminders. So here, let's say a week before the event, you want to send out a registration reminder, or excuse me, a reminder to every person who has signed up, and you can create that reminder right here. You can use templates that have already been existing, and you can set up as many of these as you want. You can also use the tell a friend option, which is not used as much anymore. Most people are using social links, but the idea here is that you can, once you completed your registration, it can go to after the thank you page, it can give you an opportunity to put in some email addresses and forward that information on to someone else. So you can tell it's a pretty sophisticated event system, and I went through basically how to set up an event. With the contributions, I went up how to look them up and work with them in the system. But just like contributions and events, you can search for event participants. I'm just going to click search. It should bring back every single event participant that's in the system today. Okay. All right. So other areas that we're going to go through are our mailings. So you can use this system. So if you use something like Constant Contact today, you do not need to use it. You can use Civi for all that. And this is a pretty good mass mailing interface. So you can send it to whomever you want in the system as long as they're in a group. So a lot of people create different mailing groups in their Civi. I have to tell you, the ability to create nice formatted messages in here is a little bit harder than in some systems. The core team is certainly working on that, but I have to admit it's a little harder than a Constant Contact or a MailChimp today. That's why I think the MailChimp extension is very popular, because people like to use the MailChimp features. And even if you use something like a MailChimp, all of your bounces and everything around that will get back into CiviCRM. So you'll know if someone's read something or whether their email bounced. And one of the biggest areas that people do not keep up on is their email good still, or has it bounced? And that's an area that just requires you to take a look at your email deliveries, and you can see who's read them, who hasn't read them, what things did they click on, and did they bounce? And that's an area that you can work on to keep your data strong and make sure that your emails are working well. Civi has a pretty sophisticated membership process also. You can have as many membership types as you want. It's popular to have maybe say a monthly subscription where you can order, let's say you've got a magazine subscription that you're putting through the system, and they got to pay you $5 a month or something like that. You can certainly do You can certainly do that. You can do rolling, or you can do fixed membership types. So rolling means that if I sign up for something on March 1st, my membership ends, let's say, the following year on February 28th. If it's a fixed, then maybe it ends December 31st, no matter what time I sign up. And you have different categories. So if I'm a new member, I can say, set me as a new member if I've been in the system for less than six months. You can do grace periods. So if I didn't sign up, if I didn't like re-sign up for my membership, I got maybe 3 months where I'll keep all of my membership qualifications in the system, and then after 3 months I will expire. And like we saw in events, you've got all the capabilities to do these reminders. So as the memberships become expired, you can remind them maybe a month before and 2 days before, or what happens that their memberships are about to expire. I see a couple other questions came in. I'm sorry if I've missed them. One asked a question about templates for confirmations. Yes, those can be customized with your logo, absolutely. And also, can you import contacts from another list? Yes, you can absolutely do that too. So you can import contributions, participants, and you can import contacts, and you can put information on those contacts when you come in, like putting them part of a group or tagging them in a certain way. I'm trying to look through, are there any other areas I wanted to cover? Those are the main areas that I wanted to cover before we talk a little bit about some of the custom data and how to work within Civi. There's also, I'm just going to mention real quick, you can do campaigns within Civi. There's a fair amount of standard reports that run within Civi, and for a lot of organizations, you can get pretty much anything you want out of here, like their different contribution reports, like contribution summaries, your top donors, some year but not this year, your live in reports. And for a lot of our very sophisticated users, these reports are not good enough and we have to do a little bit more, but for a lot of organizations this works. These work just fine. I'm not going to go into how to administer CiviCRM right now, but there are a lot of ways that you can administer it, and that would probably be a more sophisticated discussion, but you can set up your own custom fields, you can set up your different location through languages. Here's all the information around Civi Contribute, what you can set up, all your financial types, your accounts, your payment instruments, everything like that is all configurable and fairly easy to do. No, one question came in, well, how does this look on a front-end perspective? So this is primarily, like I said, a back-end user or an admin would come into CiviCRM this way. The way this interacts with the front-end are through these things called, are through these like contribution pages, or in this case, the event registration. So if I was not logged in, the event registration would look something like this, if I can get there, hold on a second. And did that not work? That did not work. All right, so I have to be logged in to do that right now. But if you forget about the sidebar over here and the top part, this is pretty much how it's going to look within your website. And then, so whatever the sidebar and headers and things that you have on your website are going to be wrapped around this Civi event registration page. And you can also do some things if you know CSS or other things to make this look the way you want to. This is a very simple example of one, but there's a lot of really sophisticated ones out there. I was going to take some time to sort of show you these from some of the examples that we've built, but I don't think I'm going to have enough time. Maybe if in the end I can show you some more. If I come back into here, what I want to talk a little bit about is tags, groups, custom data, and relationships. A lot of people are confused or not quite sure what they should be using when. So what I wanted to do was to find some contacts in here and just I'll look at it through a contact perspective. So let's look at Angela here. So she's got this is her summary page, and she does not have any tags. We can give her a tag over here of major donor, and she's a volunteer. And when I come back to my summary page, I will see that right there. And you can search for her that way. So any person who's a major donor, if you tag them that way, they will, when you do a search for major donors over here, they will then pop up. So tags are really easy to use, but I discourage some of their use because you can't discriminate. So even if I was an organization, I could give them the tag that was a volunteer, and maybe that wouldn't make any sense to me because that particular the organization can't volunteer. So you got to be really careful with your tags. There's also no way you can get any more data. It's just a label. So it's not very sophisticated, and if you do a lot of work in the system, you may find that these tags are difficult to work with because there's just not a lot of information that you can put on one. But you know, this is the only thing you want to know: this person is a volunteer. There you now see she comes up in that search, where before I had her in there, she would not come up. The other thing with tags is you don't know a start and an end date. So you want to know when someone became a major donor, for example, or became a volunteer, or they were a volunteer. You're just not going to know that with a tag, and that where you're going to that you can use something else like a relationship or a piece of custom data. I like to use relationships when the start and end date is really important. So if I add this relationship, let's say I'm going to add the case coordinator, and they're going to be the case coordinator for Justina, and the start date was December 1st, 2014. So now, what the good part is, I can see the start or I can see the end date of that relationship. So if those dates are important to you, then I wouldn't just tag someone as a case coordinator. And also, if the relationship of who they're the case coordinator for is important to you, then that's when relationships are really crucial. You can also add custom data to relationships. So if you wanted to know things like, you know, how often do they meet, where do they meet, what type of work are they working on together? You can add all that information in here, and then you can search on those. So it gives you a lot better and a lot richer environment to which you can put your data in. The disadvantage is that it's not on the summary screen. So here I can see, well, you know, Dr. Adams is a major donor or is a volunteer. I can't see that she's a case coordinator. I have to go to this relationship tab and see that she's a case coordinator. The other thing is, well, maybe I should put these people in a group. I don't necessarily need to know who she's a case coordinator of. I just want to know all of the case coordinators. So I can create a group of that. And groups are things that are used quite often. I think the best use of groups are public groups. So if you make a public group, that means that someone who's not logged in can add themselves or remove themselves from that group. The most common use of that is for subscriptions that are free. So someone goes onto your website and they say, I want to sign up for the newsletter. And they click a button and they put in their email address and their name, and that gets added to your system, and then they're put in this group, and the next time you send out your e-newsletter from the system, it will be they'll be on that distribution. The other thing with groups that are really popular are the smart groups, and those are things I mentioned earlier. What smart groups are is a way of saying put people in a group based on a particular criteria. So anyone that's last name starts with the letter A, if someone new goes in the system, they would automatically be part of that smart group. Anyone who has who is a member or who has the the case coordinator relationship can all go into SMART groups. You can create some very sophisticated ones, like for example, anyone who has lives within 15 miles of this zip code who's also a case coordinator, is a pretty sophisticated SMART group that that you can create. The other thing around groups is that you can also add groups to online forms. So for example, in an event, if someone signs up for an event, you can, without them knowing it, you can put them into a particular group. Or if you have a form online that someone sort of fills out for you and it's what's called a profile, that can be, they can be put into a group after filling that out. The next one after groups and relationships is custom data. Like we talked about earlier, custom data will give you a lot richer information than some of the other data. So for example, here on the constituent information, you can see that there's a lot of different data types. So there could be a yes-no question, there could be a date question, you can have a drop-down where you can pick just one. You can have something where they could pick one of these items. You could have this be a checkbox so that they can choose multiple ones. And you can save that information there. You've got the ability to put in notes to one-word answers. You can even create attachments and links to other systems. You can have something called a contact reference field, which says, not just marital status, but who am I married to, and you can pick another contact record in the system. You may want to use a relationship for that, but that's just a way to do that. What I like about custom data fields is that it gives you a lot of options, and you can say, well, this information really only needs to go for students or individuals, or it could go across all of your contacts. So it gives you a much richer interface in what you're doing. So those are the basics of the different ways that you can add to the base CiviCRM by adding tags, groups, custom data, and relationships. I see a couple other questions coming in. Couple questions on volunteer management. If you have the volunteer extension installed, you can then search for volunteers and you can generate reports and exports right from the system. What I think I want to show you guys, maybe have a few minutes, is how do you generate these exports? Maybe not through volunteers, but you'll get the same idea. So if I want to search for contacts, I'm going to go make my letter S again, and I should come up with a number of individuals. And I want to export some data. I want to pick all of these records, and I'm going to export these contacts. And then I'm going to go to a page where I'm going to select a few fields that I can export. And I've got some sort of merge options. I'm not going to go through what those exactly are. So I'm going to go over here and I'm going to pick a couple fields. So this is, if you've used other systems, pretty standard stuff where I can say, I want to find all of their birth dates. I would like to do their display name and maybe if they're an organization, I'd like to see what city they're in. Maybe it's, then if I can save this mapping, so in the future if I do this type of export every month or every week, I can save that. I'm not going to do that right now, I'm just going to export this data. And it immediately comes down to me in a CSV file that I can open. And hopefully this data will look pretty decent. So here, I see my birth date, I see my display name, and I see the different city. So even though, even if you don't have data in everything, it will at least bring down all the data that you have. So it's pretty easy to do. And of course, if I say, well, I really didn't want city, I wanted to have state, I can go back in here and make any of these changes that I want and just re-export that data. And now my export is going to be state and not city. Okay. Okay, I have just covered a lot in the last 55 minutes. I've gotten through pretty much everything that I wanted to. I'm sure there's a bazillion questions out there. Does anyone have anything that they want to ask? Either they can type it in, or at this point you can unmute yourself and ask directly. We've got a few minutes still. So does anyone have any questions they want to ask?
How quickly, if I commit to a platform like Drupal or Joomla, usually those platforms expire after 3 years, which forces me to have to, you know, either move Civi and all that kind of thing. How easy is Civi to move every 3 years to the new version of whatever platform you're on?
Well, let's say, I mean, something like Drupal, the expectation is that it's going to be around for a while, though it may upgrade from Drupal 7 to Drupal 8, let's just say, or from Drupal 6 it went to Drupal 7. That process is something that the core team works hard to make sure that it's easy. It's something that certainly will take some effort and time. If you work with a consultant organization, you know, they will probably have a fair amount of experience doing that. If you do it yourself, generally what we recommend is that there will be a process within the Civi documentation environment that will say, here are the exact steps that you need to do to move from Drupal 7 to Drupal 8, for example. In the smaller changes like Drupal 7.2 to 7.3, 7.4, you generally don't have to make any changes in Civi at all. I can't guarantee that, but that's been my experience so far. But if you can follow the upgrade procedures, you should be able to do that yourself. It just depends on how sophisticated you are. But if you've installed Drupal and Civi yourself, you should be able to do those upgrades. The other thing is there are some hosting environments that will do that for you for a fairly reasonable charge if you haven't done a lot to your system to customize it. And generally what happens if you have and they try to upgrade and it breaks, they'll bring it back to its current state, and then you'll have to find someone to help you with that upgrade and find, well, what just broke in your system. Does that make sense?
Sure.
I see a question came in that said, is there any way to generate silent auction bid sheets? Not directly in CiviCRM. I'd have to probably talk with you a little bit more on the best way to do that. But off the top of my head, I'd have to say not directly. I would probably export the information that you'd want and then you know, create the bid sheet outside the system. I'm not overly familiar with the best way to do that, so I'm sorry.
Would a custom report do the bid sheet?
It certainly could. The custom reports are a little bit, they're more like an Excel export than anything else. But you certainly could. I mean, we use a system called Jasper Reports, which is another open source tool to do some fairly sophisticated reporting. You might be able to use that. And that's if you push me and say, well, yeah, I need an answer, that's what I would say would work for you. But I'm not positive. Here's a question that came in about bogus contacts. That is a big issue out there in the Civi community. So that's going to be the last question I'm going to be able to answer right now. But that's a really big issue. How do they get into your system? Well, whenever you have an open environment like CiviCRM is, where people can sign up for subscriptions and things like that, you've always got to worry about two things. One is overwriting someone's data, and the second is coming in with bogus or repeat data of the same for the same person. The biggest issue with bogus data, right, is that you get someone either a bot or actually people, which we see more and more now, who are, I'm not sure where they are in the world, but they will fill out forms. We'll fill out forms and try that. That will be a way that they can fill out the form and try to create a contact record and see how they can get into your to your system. You know, some ways to prevent that is to eliminate a lot of what you can do online without logging in, and that's, you know, obviously reduces the amount of functionality that you can have, but that's always the safest thing, is to have someone create an account and then have that account be approved by someone in your organization, and then they can do stuff. But if that way it doesn't really work for you, some of the things are is to put CAPTCHA on those forms, or you can use some other sophisticated tools like Mullum if you're using Drupal, that will basically figure out where that person's coming from, and it will know if they're a known spammer or not, and they can block those people from entering in the system. And there's a couple other ones called like Honeypot, and there's a couple other ones out there like that. A couple though at times is that people will actually create their profiles or their like event pages in a way that will just screw up their data. And in that way is, for example, how are you matching your records? So if you have a situation where you're going to match on email, so if someone puts in, like, my email is pcogan@backofficethinking.com. So if someone goes in there and creates a profile with pcogan@backofficethinking.com and then also fills out a bunch of information on my name and address that's completely bogus, it's going to update my information in the system, and that's not good. So you have to be careful on how you set up those profiles. The other thing on sort of the opposite side is that you make the matching rule such that it's almost impossible. So let's say you want it's email and first name and last name and city. And you put a form out there and you don't even put city on that form, there's no way for that profile to match on my record. So it's just going to create a new one and a new one and a new one. And we see some of our clients doing that as well. I think the most important thing to do is to take a look at your data on a fairly regular basis and look, am I overwriting data or am I creating a lot of new contacts in the system, and take a look at how are people interacting from your website back into your Civi. And it's a sophisticated process. I can't really get into too much of the detail right now, but that's a very important thing, and you have to understand how that works. With CiviCRM or any system that's going to interact on the web with people who are not logged in. So unfortunately, this is all the time that we have right now. Certainly if you're interested in learning more, there's a lot of Civi forums, and there's another webinar coming up next month. I encourage you to go on the forums to read the documentation. There's a fair amount of documentation on CiviCRM out there on the web now, and hopefully you can get a lot of those questions answered. Hopefully this was helpful to you, and try to throw out as much information as I could in the last hour, and look forward to everyone becoming a CiviCRM user and continuing to build just this great ecosystem that we've been building over the last 10 years. So thank you very much. Take care.
Cash someplace? Is this accessible? This training accessible, or not really?
I'm sorry.
Is this particular webinar accessible after the fact?
Yeah, I'm actually recording it, so you can come back and take a look at it. There's also, if you Google Civi Teacher and sign up for that, you can get a lot of free webinars. Or I shouldn't say free because it costs money to sign up for Civi. There's a lot of available little webinars on different parts that will give you more information on sort of each of these modules.
Well, thank you for a phenomenal overview. This is phenomenal. Thank you.
Sure. You're welcome. Take care. Bye-bye.
Very informative. Thanks.